People keep asking me if they should play Witcher 1 and 2 before playing Witcher 3. What some people don't know is that there were actually 7 whole books written by Polish author Andrzej Sapkowski that happened even before the first game story-wise, and the story of the books is more relevant to Witcher 3 than the first two games in my opinion. So I'm just gonna go ahead and spoil everything for you so you can just jump into Witcher 3. Obviously, massive spoilers for the Witcher books and the first two games ahead. But don't worry, I won't spoil anything from Witcher 3. This video could also be interesting to those who have only played the games or just Witcher 3 and are interested in knowing more about the backstory. By the way, disclaimer, I haven't actually read the books because reading is for losers, but believe me, I've done a lot of research about the lore. Still, this will only be a very simplified recap. It's also bound to have inaccuracies, and I'm sure I'll get some angry comments from people who have actually read the books and know everything in detail. Also, I already mispronounce half of the English vocabulary, but I'm probably gonna mispronounce a lot of names that never appear in the games too, so sorry about that. Anyway, let's begin. So this is the main world in The Witcher. There's this massive empire called the Nilfgaard, which has inspirations from the Roman Empire. They strive for order and conquest and so on. Then to the north there are a bunch of independent kingdoms, the main ones being Temeria, Redania, Aedirn and Cadven. There's also the Skellige Isles to the west, whose culture is heavily inspired by the Vikings. So in the off chance you didn't know this already, Geralt of Rivia is a Witcher. Now, Witchers are humans who are specialized in slaying monsters. Apart from constant training and studying, they go through the Trial of the Grasses when they're children, where they acquire genetic mutations that heighten their senses and make them much more agile. Witchers are commonly hired in special contracts, where they're instructed to kill a monster that's been harassing a village, for example. Basically, Witchers are pretty badass. Anyway, one of the earliest major stories in the books involves Emhyr. You may know him from Witcher 3. At the time, he was the son of the Nilfgaardian Emperor. A sorcerer had put a curse on him, which turned him into a hedgehog-man hybrid thing during the day. As hedgehog-man, he escaped Nilfgaard and took on a new identity, calling himself Dooney. He kept the fact that he was actually Emhyr a secret. This footage is from a Polish movie about The Witcher, by the way. It's amazing and you should watch it, it's called Weedsman or something. The scene is totally unrelated to what I'm talking about, but I had to include it as it's the best scene in movie history. Now in Sintra, one of the northern kingdoms, Dooney met Princess Pavetta, daughter of Sintrian Queen Calant, and he wanted to marry her. Now it's good to note that through the bloodline of the Sintrian royal family runs what's called the Elder Blood. This is like a genetic mutation created by the elves that makes anyone that has it a very powerful magical source. It allows them to create huge magical explosion things and even teleport between different dimensions or worlds. Basically, sources are pretty epic. But this power is very hard to control, and like, if they get really angry they can accidentally release a bunch of power and cause a lot of damage. At some point, an elf slept with a human, so the gene now runs within the human Sintrian royalty. Okay, so anyway, while in the Sintrian palace, Dooney's helmet was removed and everyone realized he was actually a hedgehog man, so a bunch of guys immediately tried to kill him. Finally, Geralt came into play and saved Dooney's life. Because of this, Geralt involved what's called the Law of Surprise. This law was commonly used by Witchers to recruit children to train into new Witchers. Basically, after saving someone's life, in return they would demand that which you already have but do not know. This commonly referred to a child that the person's wife would have already conceived, but the husband did not know about yet. Basically, a Witcher saves your life, and then he goes, "Surprise, now I take your child." In Dooney's case, Pavetta had already conceived a daughter, which Dooney did not know about. This child was Ciri, a very important character in Witcher 3. After she was born and it was finally time for Geralt to take her with him, he actually decided not to, cause he's cool and he does what he wants. By marrying Pavetta, Dooney's curse was lifted, so he stopped being hedgehog man and just became man-man. Now that he looked like a normal human again, he wanted to take back the Nilfgaardian throne. throne. He faked his own death as Dúni and travelled to Nilfgaard as Emhyr, where he did become emperor. He wanted to take Ciri and Pavetta with him, but Pavetta didn't want to, and long story short, he ended up accidentally killing Pavetta, while Ciri remained in Sintra, being raised by her grandmother, Queen Calant. She also spent a lot of her childhood in Skellige. So sometime later, Emhyr's army invaded Sintra, partly to get Ciri back to him, and they slaughtered everything and everyone, because why not? Seeing all the destruction, Queen Calant committed suicide. F in the chat for Calant. But Ciri managed to escape Sintra, and she was later adopted by a random family. By chance, Geralt ended up saving the life of her new adoptive father, and surprise, he invoked the law of surprise to recruit Ciri once again. This time Geralt decided to take her with him to the Witcher School of the Wolf in Kaer Morhen, cause he's cool and he does what he wants. Destiny is a prevailing theme in The Witcher, and it is implied that Ciri and Geralt were always destined to be a part of each other's lives. But Emhyr was still looking for Ciri. He had his own political reasons to reunite with her too. There was this very powerful wizard called Vilgefortz, who convinced Emhyr that to fulfill a prophecy, he had to have a child with Ciri. Yeah. Itilin's prophecy, as it was called, was an old elven prophecy that claimed that a child of the elder blood would end up ruining the world and saving it from its inevitable end. After Sintra's destruction by Nilfgaard, Emhyr marrying Ciri would also help solidify his legitimacy to rule over Sintra, since Ciri was Sintrian royalty after all. Keep in mind that no one except for him knew that Emhyr was Ciri's father, since no one knew that Emhyr was Dúni all along, so no one else was gonna find this weird. The Northern Kingdoms were also looking for Ciri, to have her killed instead, so that Emhyr's plans to gain the right to rule Sintra would be stopped. Later on, the Emperor actually went with a plan B, and ended up marrying a fake imposter Ciri instead. At Kaer Morhen, Geralt raised Ciri as his own daughter, and him and his fellow Witcher friends, Vesemir and co, gave her Witcher training. Except she was never given the Witcher mutations. Triss, a sorceress that you may know from the Witcher games, was summoned to Kaer Morhen to teach Ciri to control her elder blood powers, but she wasn't very successful at this. So Ciri was later sent to Yennefer, a more experienced sorceress, at the Temple of Melitele. Geralt's love life was a bit complicated, but Yennefer was his lover most of the time. Yen continued raising Ciri herself, and she became her mother figure. At one point, a meeting between mages was held at Tanned Island. Yennefer, Triss, Ciri, and Geralt were all present. This meeting went horribly wrong. Mages siding with Nilfgaard ended up fighting against the mages siding with the Northern Kingdoms, and a bunch of people died. Vilgefortz was one of the sorcerers that had planned the fight, and while Ciri was in the same place as him, he attempted to capture her. He too personally wanted her for her elder blood powers. Geralt tried to fight him, but Vilgefortz was too powerful and won the fight, though Ciri was able to escape through a portal just in time. On a side note, while the Tanned meeting was happening, King Vesemir of Redania, father of Radovid in Witcher 3, was assassinated, F in the chat. It is implied that Philippa Eilhart, a sorceress working for the king himself, had something to do with this murder. Jikstra, a Redanian spy and colleague of Philippa, started looking into it but had to go into hiding when assassins tried to kill him too. It is implied that Philippa had sent these assassins onto Jikstra as well. After all of this, Philippa got a few female sorceresses together, including Triss, and formed the Lodge of Sorceresses, which would try to unite the mages and protect their interests. They also wanted to get Ciri involved, due to her magical and political importance, and they tried to get to her through Yennefer, though rather unsuccessfully. They also wanted her to conceive a child, of course, but with a prince of Kovir instead, a kingdom that was favorable to magic. From this point onward, Ciri was living on the run for a while. She had some interesting stories, but I'm just gonna summarize this period very heavily and will leave a lot out. Basically, she lived with a bandit group called the Rats for some time, where she even had a brief loving relationship with another girl. Then a bounty hunter called Leobon Hart came, killed them all, and captured Ciri. Then she escaped and traveled to the world of the Anel, a world ruled by elves. There, Avalak, also from Witcher 3, wanted to have her breed with their elf king Oberon for a change. This is so that the elder blood would pass on back to the elves, and also because of Itilin's prophecy. King Oberon later got assassinated by Eredin, leader of the Wild Hunt. The Wild Hunt are a group of elven riders that are pretty important in Witcher 3. I mean, it's literally called the Witcher 3 Wild Hunt. They also wanted Ciri for her power, so now we can add them to the list of people interested in Ciri, which includes pretty much everyone at this point. Ciri had to escape from this world as well, and she managed to do so with the help of a unicorn. Yeah, I'm serious. Ciri stayed on the run. By now she had learned to control her teleportation powers pretty well, so she kept traveling between different worlds like normal people do. In the meantime, Yennefer, while searching for Ciri, had been taken captive by Vilkvorts at Stiga Castle. He planned to use her as bait for Ciri, and it worked. When Ciri started searching for Yennefer, she tried to save Yen, but got captured herself as well. Geralt was also searching for Yen and Ciri with the help of a few friends. One of these friends was Regis, a higher vampire that's also in the Blood and Wine DLC of Witcher 3. Vilgefortz was so powerful that he pretty much defeated them all, but Geralt managed to trick him using a magical illusion and finally killed him once and for all, cause Geralt is cool and he does what he wants. And then the bounty hunter Leobon Hart came to Stiga Castle, but Ciri defeated him this time. And then Emperor Emhyr came to Stiga Castle too, cause he was like, everyone seems to be going to Stiga Castle at this time of year, might as well go myself as well. And when he finally found Ciri, Emhyr took her with him and ordered both Geralt and Yennefer to be killed. But having actually met Ciri made him finally realize that impregnating his own daughter would be pretty weird, so he quickly changed his mind and let all three of them go. Fast forwarding a bit, at one point Geralt found himself defending non-humans from a violent riot started by humans, and some random guy fatally stabbed him with a pitchfork. Yennefer tried to save him with magic, but spent all her life energy doing so, and they both died. A massive F in the chat, please. The end. Yeah, seriously, this is pretty much how the books end. Ciri actually came in to save them both, and with the help of the same unicorn as before, she took them to a mysterious island to rest. But the books leave it ambiguous whether this actually happened, or whether it was just Ciri's imagination, or whether the island was a metaphor for limbo or heaven. When CD Projekt Red got the license to make the games, they added a bit of their own backstory between the end of the books and the start of Witcher 1. So obviously, according to CDPR, Ciri did actually save Geralt and Yen's lives. Otherwise, Geralt wouldn't be alive for the games, and that would be pretty unepic. The Wild Hunt, still searching for Ciri, later abducted Yennefer as bait, similar to what Vilgefortz had done before. Geralt spent a lot of time hunting the Wild Hunt to try and save Yen, with the help of another witcher called Leto. He finally found them and chose to trade himself for Yennefer, which the Wild Hunt accepted. Geralt rode with the Wild Hunt for a while until he was somehow freed, when he found himself close to Kaer Morhen with his memory wiped out. This is where Witcher 1 starts. The first game story is not too relevant with Witcher 3. Basically, Geralt rejoined Triss and his Witcher friends at Kaer Morhen. Having forgotten all about Yennefer, he also romanced Triss. Some bandit guys raided their fort and stole their mutagenic secrets, with the aim to raise an army of monsters and take over Temeria, ruled by King Foltest. But in the end, Geralt managed to ruin their plans because he's cool and he does what he wants. So on to Witcher 2 now. Remember Witcher Leto? Yeah, Emhyr had now secretly hired him to assassinate as many northern kings as he could, with the aim of stirring up chaos, and thus making it easier for Nilfgaard to conquer the north. Leto cleverly tried to work with other groups for each regicide, so there could always be someone else to frame. He first went for King Demavend of Aedirn. For this one, he worked with the Lodge of Sorceresses, as they had planned to set up a small nation ruled by mages, and Demavend was an obstacle to their plan. After him, he went for King Foltest of Temeria, and this time he worked with the Skoyatel, a rebel group of non-humans that kill humans because of the rampant racial discrimination in the Northern Kingdoms. Geralt was literally in the same room as Foltest during the assassination, so he was wrongly blamed for the murder. F in the chat for the fallen kingdoms, by the way. Vernon Roche, a Temerian commander, knew that Geralt was innocent though, so he freed him and asked him to help find the real assassin. At a summit in Loch Muin, the lodge was framed for both regicides. All sorceresses were either imprisoned or else had to go into hiding. Philippa Eilhart even had her eyes gouged out by King Radovid of Redania because of her involvement, though she later escaped imprisonment. Magic in general started being seen in a very negative light after this, and especially in Redania, mages started being hunted and persecuted. At the end of Witcher 2, Geralt finally learns that Leto was behind the assassinations all along, and you as a player have to choose whether to kill him or spare him. Along the journey of Witcher 2, Geralt started gradually regaining his memory back, and by the game's end, he had remembered everything, including Yennefer and Ciri. Witcher 3 starts a few months after Witcher 2. The Nilfgaardian invasion has already started, and the Empire has easily taken over the now kingless Temeria. Their main remaining obstacle is Redania, currently ruled by Radovid. At the start of Witcher 3, Geralt receives a letter from Yennefer asking him to meet her, as Ciri has appeared in this world again, and the Wild Hunt are after her. Also, Geralt has become a big fan of Gwent. That's it, smash like if you enjoyed, bye.